They have unique responsibilities under the Constitution. You know, our state officials very seldom get involved in national defense, national security, U.S. vital interests, foreign policy, or highly classified issues. But only the U.S. senators confirm our senior military leaders, the full colonels, the generals, the admirals. Now, I know for me, when I made full colonel, I was surprised morning by your planet. It's only about 1 out of 7 lieutenant colonels, 1 out of 6, depends on the year. But you can't pin the Eagles on until the U.S. Senate confirms you. And for me, if you're going to be deciding if someone's qualified to be a colonel or a general or an admiral, I wish that you would have some serious real-world experience of what they do and what they're up against. And you don't get that in a political campaign. You know, only our U.S. senators confirm our ambassadors and our senior State Department officials. And if you're going to be deciding who's going to be a U.S. ambassador or a senior State Department official and represent our country's interests to all nations that we have relationships with, and that's our front line of defense, I think you should have some serious real-world experience at least once working with the U.S. Embassy on foreign soil and understanding the integration and the collaboration of our defense intelligence agencies and our military operations in that country, as well as our political relationships with that country's chief executive. You know, only the U.S. Senate confirms our treaties. This is serious business. You wonder why we're in this war, or you wonder why we have this trade agreement, or why we have this going on. Oftentimes, we can go back to the treaties. U.S. treaties commit our country, not just politically, but economically and militarily. Now, I know for me, doing war college is where I best learned how to do that. I think if you're going to be signing our name to a blank check of a treaty, that I would like to see you have some serious, real-world education, training, experience as to how that process works and just what you're committing us to. You know, only the U.S. Senate confirms the presidential cabinet. Now, if you take a look, there's a close alignment between the presidential cabinet and the committees in the U.S. Senate. And that's a smart design. If you look at what they are, you have agriculture involved, you have many business involved, finance, banking, you have national security, national defense, foreign policy. And you all do remember when we had cabinet members, right? That was before we had czars. And that's about 39 folks that need to go on an unemployment line because it's constitutional. And only the U.S. Senate confirms our federal judges. And I think we can take a look at what's going on in the court system, and maybe we should have done a better job at that. Take a look at our vision for America going forward. I want our country to be a strong, prosperous, safe, proud, respected, sovereign, and we got to stay that way. We cannot allow the UN or any other countries to tell us what to do. To have strong national security, we're going to have a strong economy. Now, right now, as Republicans, everyone's watching, we all hear cut spending. I agree. We've got to cut spending. We got limited waste, fraud, abuse, redundancy, and unnecessary cost. But let me ask this, how many of you in here are in business or ever been in business? Do you ever worry about customers? Yeah. You know, this country makes its living selling our products and services against the rest of the world. I don't hear nobody talking about that right now. So let's be the business people that we are, and let's recognize that it's managing a business, and a business has two sides to a balance sheet. Yes, we got to cut spending and get rid of that unnecessary cost, and get a balanced budget amendment. We got to quit spending more than we're making, but we've got to start doing a better job selling our products and services against the rest of the world, or else we're going to continue to have to keep cut spending because that income statement is going to continue to go down. Now, you don't hear anybody talking about this, but folks, it's the reality. I don't care if you're a pancake house downtown. You can lay people off. You can close early, you can turn the air conditioner up, but at some point, if nobody's walking through that door, you're going down.
That's right.
And we better start thinking about that. Let's look at what we're up against. We're 5% of the world. Now, yes, I feel qualified to talk about this. I was the lead faculty for the Global MBA program for all the ground campuses for University of Phoenix for about 3 years, and I've taught internationally, and I have global emphasis in my doctorate in business management. My son's a lawyer, and I've asked him how much he studied all this, and he looked at me cross-eyed, so I won't say more about that. for 5% of the world. 95% of the world doesn't live here, doesn't work here, and doesn't buy here. And we're competing with them. It's a global economy. Now, I'm getting beat up because using the word global economy that I'm talking Agenda 21. Let's get serious. Global economy is not Agenda 21. Global economy is the fact that everybody on this planet is competing against everybody else for customers. If you were a vodka drinker, which I know we're not, you can go to any liquor store in Sarasota County, get Grey Goose from France, Kettle One from Holland, Stoli from Russia, or Skye from California. It's that way everywhere. I guarantee you that every morning, the president of BMW and the president of Mercedes do not get up and say, how many Germans did we hire today? They get up and say, how many cars did we sell against the other guys around the world? Or in the U.S., which is the number one car market. Same way in pharmaceuticals, same way in everything. These companies are global. Their employees are global. Their stockholders are global. Now, if we're only 5% of the world, where is everybody? All of North America is only 13. So if you hear people saying our whole problem's NAFTA, it's 13% of the world. That still leaves 87. Where are they? Asia. 57% of the world lives, works, and buys in Asia. Look at Europe, another 12%. Right there, same landmass. Virtually 70% of the world is in that one landmass. So if you're a global company, are you going to ignore that 70% and look at this 5? And what really gets interesting is now you've got China, the number two economy on the planet. It's 3, 4, and 5 are right there as well, with Japan and Germany and England. It's concentration of mass. You're not going to ignore it. And if you're a publicly held corporation, like almost everybody here that's a Fortune 500 company is, a lot of your stockholders live over there as well. What makes this really concerning is China and India alone are 40% of the world. China, with 1.2 billion people, they now have 300 million middle-class citizens, the same as us. But that still leaves down about 500 or 600 million people that can work for $5,000 a year. Now, if you're manufacturing and you have $5,000 a year labor, you may have a competitive advantage, you think? And China now, by many measurements, is the largest manufacturer of goods on the planet and the larger exporter of goods on the planet. And what really makes it scary is they have virtually no patent laws. So they just steal your research and your technology and your products and reverse engineer it and duplicate it and sell it to your customers at a greatly reduced cost. You know, if you talk to most people in industrialized nations, they're in any kind of technology industry, they'll tell you their two biggest costs are personnel burden and research and development. Here's the largest country on the planet that virtually bypasses those two costs. Do you think in a global economy that would be an advantage? One other thing, guess what country on the planet now has the most academic hours in the school year? Number two, Korea. Number three, Japan. Or like 10. They get it. We better start protecting our economic development, our research and development, our proprietary technologies. Jobs are going to keep walking away if we don't do a better job protecting these and a better job with our treaties and trade agreements. What we got to have here at home, we all know, is a business-friendly environment. We need less regulation, not more. We need more taxes, not more. And we need fewer lawsuits. We need tort reform that's effective. And then we're going to have to create and bring jobs to Florida and America. Now we hear everybody talk about that. You know, I can send a fifth grader up here. We need to create jobs, we need to grow the economy, we need to cut spending, we need to secure the border, and we need strong national defense. Elect me. Yeah, no kidding. Gee, can I write some of that down? How are we going to create jobs? It's like an Easter egg hunt. Where are they? You got to find where they are. Every job out there is in one or two places. Public sector or private sector. I think we all know we don't need more public sector jobs. We've got enough people working for the government. So we got to create private sector jobs. How are you going to do that? But where are they? Here's what we teach in operations management, the MBA curriculums. We teach value chain analysis. It's where you look at any particular company. What industry are they in? Everybody's competing in some industry, whether you're making chairs, cars, running hospitals, teaching college, whatever. You're in an industry. And every industry has a value chain. which starts at the very back end of the supply channel with the very rawest materials and moves forward as those raw materials become polished and put into components and into bigger components, and then they finally get to whatever the manufacturing facility is that makes the finished product. And then from there it goes through distribution to the retailer or end user. Every company falls in that value chain somewhere. Japan's done a better job of this than we have. But what we need to do is we need to do an effective value chain analysis on every company in Florida and America and make sure they're plugged into the mainstream of their value chain, of their industry, so that other companies are hiring them for whatever it is they do. That's what will create jobs. We got to get all these companies in America and in Florida having more customers. Maybe the person downstream from them, if you're the manufacturer, maybe that whoever, if somebody's not walking in, a retailer or online or whatever, buying your stuff, you're not plugged in.